Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Well, in 5 seconds it'll be noon, so good afternoon early. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Washington County Public Affairs Forum on Monday, December 14th, 2015. Today is our last, but perhaps even our best, program for the entire year. And of course, somebody's got to say it, so I'll say it now and get us all out of it. We'll see you next year. But before we do that, we have a very exciting program today. And give me just one quick second. Two folks renewed their membership today, which we enjoy. We enjoy new members as well. But I'd like to take a moment to thank John Bell, a long member, and Linda Barney for renewing today. I tell you, we keep growing. Before you know it, we're going to be bigger than this room, but that's a problem that we'll look forward to dealing with when it happens. Ladies and gentlemen, without any more comments from me for now, please allow me the pleasure of introducing Metro Councilors Dirksen and Harrington, and here they are.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Catherine Harrington.
And I'm Craig Dirksen.
And we have a really good time presenting together. It's sort of like the sportscasters at a sporting event. So we'll be going back and forth.
I mean, we're pleased to do this together. Between the two of us, we share Washington County on the Metro Council. Catherine is District
4.
4, which is the northern half of the county. And Catherine lives here, lives in Beaverton. And I have the southern half of the county, and I live in Tiger. So between the two of us, and we also share Alloa. Half of Alloa south of TV Highway is in my district, and the part that's north of TV Highway is in Catherine's district. So it's good for us to work together when we're in Washington County, and particularly when we're in Alloa.
So can you hear us okay? Are we talking close enough to the mic for those of you in back? Okay.
People have said a lot of things to me over my life, but can you please speak up? It's typically not one of them. It's usually the other way around.
Well, without further ado, why don't we get into today's presentation, and we each look forward to your questions at the end as well.
The two things we're going to talk about today is give you a little background on how Metro works, what Metro does, and then we'll get more deeply into things that are happening with our parks and natural areas, because there's actually a lot of things going on right now with that. I would hand it out some handouts, and I would refer you to this one, or the one that's on the screen, that looks like a little fan. This was actually something that we created as a kind of a graphic to use in a strategic planning session, and we realized when we saw it that it does a really good job of describing and explaining all the things, the different things that Metro does. So we've been sharing it as we go out into the community. If you look across the bottom, it talks about, there's two sides. On the left side, it talks about policy and plans and programs and places and services, and those are the things that Metro does. And then on the right side, it kind of talks about how we try to achieve those through, we'd like to, as leaders in the community, to inspire people, to engage the community in conversation and discussion about our region, and also to teach and share information about all the things that we do, and then invite people to come together and talk with us. One of Metro's great opportunities is to be a regional convener, to bring together representatives from the 25 cities and 3 counties that form the Metro area, bring everybody to one table to talk about issues like land use and transportation, so many other things. Then if you look in the body of the fan, there, just up from the bottom, there are 4 different areas where we primarily work. And going from right to left, we've got our venue system, where we run the Oregon Zoo, we run the Oregon Convention Center, we administer the Centers for the Performing Arts in downtown Portland, and the Expo Center, all those things. Then the next one up, Parks and Nature System. We're responsible for 17,000 acres of parks and open space across the whole metro area, from Canama Bluffs on the south to Cooper Mountain out here, to Scouters Mountain and Oxbow Park in the eastern part of Washington, of Multnomah County. So we have a lot of opportunities and challenges there, and we'll talk more about those later today. Then as you go around, we also land use and transportation system. We have responsibility from the state of coordinating all the land use between those 25 cities and three counties throughout the metro area. And we also act as the Metropolitan Planning Organization for the entire metro area, which means that all federal funding for transportation that comes into the region has to come through us and be applied to plans that we've approved. And then finally, down on the far side, the most exciting part of our job, and that's the garbage and recycling system. Believe it or not, that was actually Metro's first job. And it is actually still the source of most of our revenue, because we collect tipping fees and excise taxes on garbage that's sent to landfills. And so we're responsible for coordinating all of the, when the garbage truck comes to your house, I'll put it this way, comes to your house and they pick it up, where does that garbage truck go? They bring it to us and we have to figure out what to do with it. And we recycle as much of it as we can, but a lot of it goes to landfills, most of it to a landfill in Eastern Oregon. A truck leaves Portland every 28 minutes headed toward Arlington with about 30 tons of garbage in each truck. And so that goes on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So we do that as well. Then if you look clear out to the edge, you'll see some things that say equity and prosperity, healthy ecosystems, vibrant communities, transportation choices, and clean air and water. And those are what we call the six desired outcomes. And all of the things we do, we aspire to achieve those six outcomes that we call on the outside. So all of the things we do, Metro Council in the center, and branching out through all the different things we do and how we do it, is to achieve those six goals. So I hope that does a little bit of a job of kind of explaining all the different things we do, how we do them, and kind of why as well. Catherine, anything you'd like to add on
just,
that?
Just a little bit. So to add some of the color commentary, Craig did a great job of explaining how we have a very unique portfolio as an elected regional government, and we are the first elected regional government in the United States. Touching on some of the most recent topics he hit on, garbage and recycling. Well, here in Washington County, there aren't as many convenient transfer stations or household hazardous waste collection sites for you to take some materials to. So Metro sponsors over 35 neighborhood roundup events right here in Washington County. And our two districts, those of you who live in Washington County, are the beneficiaries of those services. On land use and transportation, we do a lot of work with our peer agency governments. And some of the programs that Metro administers really goes through to the local community. So we really do a tremendous amount of work together in partnership. Craig mentioned some of the really terrific park venues that we have. The other handout that we brought for you is our newsletter called Our Big Backyard. And in that we have articles, but it also has a list of calendar events on a seasonal basis. We put this out in hard copy form that goes to various library locations, but all of this information is also available on our website, OregonMetro.gov. And as we've had tremendous rains over the last week and a half, I've really been impressed. I've been on the Metro Council for 9 years, Craig rapidly approaching 4 years. And over those years, we've been really fortunate to work with you, the public, volunteers who've contributed your time, as well as our local park districts, soil and water conservation districts, to improve the health of floodplains. So believe it or not, we're not experiencing as much local flooding as we have in decades past because of those investments. And lastly, on visitor venues, Craig mentioned the places, but like me, you may have gone to see the Nutcracker Ballet or Icing in downtown Portland. You may go to some of the consumer shows at Expo. I like to go to the RV show on occasion. It's a real fantasy of mine. The dog show is another great one. And we even had a drive-in theater series this past summer. It was very successful. and I hope that you'll look forward to that again this upcoming summer. So that's just bringing to life a little bit more of the vast responsibilities that Craig summarized for us.
Would now be a good time to mention the zoo and talk about that, since we're talking
Absolutely.
About venues?
You bet.
We also are responsible for running the Oregon Zoo, and as you may know, the citizens, all of us together, passed a $125 million zoo bond levy several years ago to do improvements to the zoo. And we're about halfway through with that or so, and next week we're going to be formally opening our new elephant lands, where we have completely rebuilt the elephant exhibit at the zoo, expanding it from just over about 1.5 acres to over 6 acres for the 7 elephants that we have at the Oregon Zoo. It also includes improvements to how they're fed, ways to stimulate them in natural ways so that their lifestyle can be more like it is in the wild. In the past, most of the exhibit they walked around on concrete, which we discovered over time is not good for their feet. So the new exhibit, almost all of it is now natural surfaces, a lot of sand and a lot of other things. They also have a large water wallow, which is just open for them to use just yesterday. And so a large expansion, again, is opening literally tomorrow. So I would encourage, if you have the opportunity to come to the zoo tomorrow or this week and see the new elephant lands, it's going to be truly amazing. In addition to the elephant lands, we've also built a new state-of-the-art clinic, I would almost call it hospital, for the animals, which we've never had before. And as the zoo has grown and improved, we've really needed and now have that. We also just broke ground on a new conservation education system and center where hundreds, thousands of young students come to the zoo and learn about animals and learn about conservation. Next up, we're going to be rebuilding the polar bear exhibit and making some other changes to improving the rhinoceros exhibit. We've also improved the penguin exhibit, and we're going to be upgrading the primate exhibits as well. By 2020, when we are done, over 40% of the zoo will be new and improved. So we'd encourage people to come out. The elephant lands is truly incredible. We have a world-class elephant program recognized around the world as being one of the premier areas for research into elephant behaviors and elephant conservation. People come from all over the world to see how we do it. And we're very proud of what's going to be opened, and it's going to be so great for the elephants as well.
And as he mentioned with elephant lands, there's a new building called Forest Hall, which has phenomenal exhibits for all of us to learn more about the herd, but also you'll get to look at the elephants indoors. It's set up like an amphitheater, so you'll be able to see them, you know, at ground level, but also from on high. So this is actually a terrific time of year to go to the zoo and check it out. So you don't have to only visit the zoo during rainy summer, sunny summer time. So, great. Well, why don't we move on? And please do let us know along the way if you have questions. Let me just grab some notes over here. I have some various facts and figures that I want to make sure that I get right for you. So together we have protected over 17,000 acres, and it's really because of you that we've been able to do this together. And so now Metro has quite a portfolio that we're responsible for managing on the public's behalf. It happened because the voters of our region approved 2 different bond measures as well as a levy to take care of these lands. What we certainly know is that people here in our region are passionate about nature. We made investments through these 2 bond measures to acquire land to make sure that it was protected. And so the public does have that tremendous legacy to leave for future generations. And with the levy, we've been able to really advance our restoration techniques, which is providing access to nature for people of all ages, but is also improving science-based education for our young students, as well as contributing to our resiliency as a region. We do this work, as I mentioned earlier, in partnership. It's not just Metro that does this work. We work with the counties, each of the three, including Washington County, the 25 cities, but also the soil and water conservation districts that are really chartered to make sure that we're doing our part to protect habitat for the salmon, a really incredible species that we are known for here in the Pacific Northwest. We also are grateful to have people living in our region who care for nature, enjoying it, but also rolling up their sleeves, pulling ivy, planting new plant material. For example, along Hull Creek in the city of Beaverton recently, the city staff went in, prepared the banks, and over a number of weekends, we've had people of all ages participate in planting the little plants, the ferns, the bushes, and even trees. And that's one reason why Cedar Hills Boulevard hasn't flooded in the last week and a half, because of improvements like that. So it's quite a portfolio, and we need to make sure that we have a strategic path moving forward. So we've been putting together a Parks and Natural Areas System Plan. And in doing so, we've talked to a tremendous number of people about how we should organize our work, what we should use to guide our investments, not just of money, but our own scientists and research, and making sure that our future decision-making will be guided by that information. We want to make sure that Metro fills its niche. We're not trying to be all things to every property, and we really value the partnerships. So it goes back to working with all of our local governments, our service district, park districts, and you, the wonderful volunteers of our region. So we're going to talk a little bit more about how we've been going about putting together this strategic plan. This highlights a vast array of community investments that we've been making. I'm hopeful.
Does it show? I mean, look.
It looks like the green.
Yeah, it doesn't look too bad.
The light green colors that you see all over the place are natural area purchases, so lands that Metro has acquired thanks to you. And then you see different colors and shapes. Part of each of the two bonds has included a local share component. These are dollars that have gone right to our local cities, counties, and park districts to acquire parkland, to improve parkland, and improve the care of those lands. The little circles you see are capital grants. Those are investments that total $50,000 or more, and you can see that we've made investments throughout our region. The little blue circles that you see, those are what we call community grants, in addition to the little purple ones. And those are ones that have really taken shape by virtue of local community groups. One of the stories I love is with a church. When they were working on their sustainability goals, they realized that, gee, we have a sizable piece of property behind the church. It backs up to Kellogg Lake. And they decided that first things first, they needed to make sure that they were taking care of their grounds and being as sustainable as possible. So they sought out some help at Metro through one of these community restoration grants. And with that, they were able to take their volunteer hours of people willing to do work to pull ivy and to plant native plant materials and use that as a match to our grant funds. And our grant funds paid for bringing in the heavy equipment to remove the not only the invasive species that were in there, but also the shopping carts and tires and other bad things that had gotten into the lake over decades. And now they have much higher quality there in Kellogg Lake. So you can see that many of these are really done in partnership.
So for the last 20 years, we've been buying land, land that we've identified and recognized as being important to protect as open space, either for reasons of environmental reasons, for water quality, or for wildlife habitat, or areas that are just underserved and just don't have much in the way of open space for people to go and enjoy nature. So working together with our partners across the region, now through the levy and our work on the plan, it's how do we take these disparate pieces of property and how do we turn them into a system that works together both scientifically and socially. Fortunately, the Metro Council doesn't have to figure out how to do this. Fortunately, we have a cadre of environmental scientists and park rangers and others who are professionals in their fields who know how to do this, and they've been working on this for some time along with our partners, how to put this together.
And I'm really pleased with the information that I've had the opportunity to learn from our scientists and that they have tried to share through the Our Big Backyard publication. For example, much like in our lifetimes, nutritional science was born in the 1960s, and we're all living longer as a result of that. So too with restoration techniques. So over, well, let's see, 20 years ago, the idea of restoring a floodplain was scraping out the invasive species and planting, for example, native grasses, one type. Well, unfortunately, that led to a monoculture. And scientific analysis has been done through that time, and with the help of our scientists, they've been able to improve the diversity of those floodplains, which is now to our level of success now.
So we've been spending a lot of time and resources in the last decade or so taking the pieces of property that we've purchased that were often in an environmentally degraded state. Either they've been used for agriculture or there was invasive species, and we've been working to restore them back to their natural state, what they would have looked like 200 or 300 years ago.
And we have some examples of that coming up in our slides.
Now, it's not all big. In some cases, it's small neighborhood gardens.
Yep. Here you see a picture in Cornelius of the community gardens that have been built with the new Virginia Garcia Memorial Health Center. Two things were achieved through the improvements on what had formerly been an alleyway. So we've planted native plants in a couple of different planting gardens there, but also implemented the community gardens. This is a picture from this time of year, and in the summer it's really lush and vibrant, and I should probably start adding that as another slide in here. It's much more interesting. Yeah. Fano Creek is another one.
The Fano Creek Trail eventually will go all the way from the Willamette River in the south all the way up to the city of Portland in the north. And we're working to tie those pieces together as they go through Tualatin and Tigard and Beaverton and up through the city of Portland to link the pieces of trail that exist into one continuous trail that you'll be able to access all the way up and down the west side. Goes through many large natural areas along the way. Some are just a couple of acres, some are just little strips along the creek where we've just protected what's called the riparian corridor right along the creek. In other areas, it goes through large areas that are tens or even hundreds of acres that are tied together into one kind of corridor, both for water and for wildlife.
If you haven't explored the Fano Creek Trail, coming this spring, right now, a big section of it's underwater, unfortunately. But from the Garden Home Rec Center, which is one of the THPRD sites in Garden Home, you can walk or bicycle all the way down to Tualatin, crossing the Tualatin River, and all kinds of points in between. There are a few areas where you have to walk up on sidewalks, and it's a little less unnatural. Or far away from nature, but we're continuing to make improvements along the way. We've also invested in bringing you new major parks. Here you see a picture from Scouters Mountain in Happy Valley. It is the newest to the portfolio. Adding to Cooper Mountain, Eric and I were just up at Cooper Mountain yesterday, a beautiful park to see all different times of year. I love exploring it in different seasons, as well as Graham Oaks Nature Park down in Wilsonville, and Mount Talbert out in Clackamas County, which is that beautiful butte that you can see right from 205, and it's got some great trails in there as well. I remember taking the time one. Well, yes, of course. Craig was reminding me of Dirksen Nature Park that the city of Tigard takes care of, and I'll have him speak to that. But these four that I mentioned are ones that Metro brings to you and takes care of and are really great sights to see.
Well, enough said. It is one of the larger parks in the city of Tigard and is part of the Fano Creek Trail link between Tualatin and Beaverton as well.
So reinforcing the point, I wouldn't be at Metro if not for maps. I love maps. And here's just another illustration of the kind of work that we're doing on your behalf. The green circles illustrate various parks throughout our region. As we mentioned, we manage over 17,000 acres. Just under a quarter of that are parks that were facilities that were transferred from Multnomah County to Metro. And they're primarily over in the Multnomah County area, and they include Blue Lake Park, as well as Oxbow Regional Park. And if you haven't been to those two, I really suggest you put them on your list of places to go this upcoming next year. Oxbow especially has old growth forest. It's right there down on the Sandy River. It's just amazing. And it even has overnight camping, and you can reserve those spots on the internet as well. We also are responsible for 14 historic cemeteries. And many of these serve as park-like areas in the communities that they are part of. Lone Fir Cemetery is the largest with 30 acres. It also serves, in a way, as an arboretum. There are some historic trees as there.
It was recently voted one of the top 10 most picturesque cemeteries in the United States.
Yeah, by National Geographic.
Mm-hmm. I think so.
Geographic Traveler.
And many of the families who have streets named after them have family members who are buried in that cemetery going back over 150 years.
Like Lovejoy, Esther Poole is also buried there. And I came to know of Esther Poole through celebrating the right of women's vote here in Oregon. And she played a big part in that. So thanks to her, I get to vote. So the white circles with a little green sun that you may or may not be able to see are sites that are being planned for public access. So in Washington County, over on the western side near the city of Banks, you can see Killen Wetlands. That is a great site. There are over 560 acres there. And what we've experienced over the years is that birders were using their scopes from the side of the road, and it was really quite dangerous. So we've gone through a master planning process, and about 60 acres will be opened up for public access. We'll have trails so that people can get down to various sites to see these birds. But also there will be various trails to disperse classrooms so that kids will have another resource for their science learning. It's also a very special site because it's the only Willamette peat bog that is in public ownership here in Oregon. It's a really very special place. But in addition to Killen Wetlands, also here in Washington County, is Orenco Woods. In partnership with the city of Hillsboro, we're opening up a new nature park just off of Cornelius Pass Road. And also the Tualatin Riverboat Launch will be opening up in another couple of years as well, which I'm sure Marilyn will take advantage of. It really helps link up with a couple of other available sites. Next, we've been in the process of doing master planning for the North Tualatin Mountains up in Multnomah County, but pretty soon we're going to, down in this area, I think of your slide, is Chehalem Ridge, which is just south of Forest Grove, Hillsborough, and Cornelius. We're going to start the master planning for that, as well as some site access up on Council Creek. So this gives you an illustration of how dramatic the recent acquisitions have occurred here in Washington County and throughout the region, and how with your support through the levy that you approved in May of 2013, we've been able to not only do the restoration we talked about with you, but also make appropriate sites available for the benefit of our public. Oh, yes. I've talked a little bit about restoration efforts, and Craig mentioned the history of some of these sites. This is a site we call Maroon Ponds. This is a site where Metro worked with Clean Water Services, our sewerage agency here in Washington County. They take care of not only our sewage when we flush our toilets, but also they are our stormwater agency as well. Maroon Ponds is along the Tualatin River, just north of the Joint Water Commission drinking water plant that filters all of our water that comes out of our faucets. This was historic agriculture land, and by working cooperatively, we were able to recontour that site, take out some historic material that wasn't good to have in a floodplain, and we've been also able to invest in restoration, so we have a very healthy beaver population. Boy, I've gotten to learn what engineers beavers are, and it's also benefiting many birds as well. Really exciting stuff. And here, we were on a tour at Blue Lake Park, seeing the various visitor improvements that are happening there. It's a really large park. You can go there, see native plant gardens. You can go fishing on Blue Lake. You can go paddle boating. We've had different events there. It also has a disc golf course, and it has huge picnic facilities for groups and families. So we've made improvements to the visitor access when you come in, and we've also replaced all of the historic restrooms that were there, making them fully ADA compliant as well. But it's not just about the places, the physicality, but also how we've been providing services to you, our public. One of the things we've really tried to work hard at is engaging with aspects of our community that really historically we've not done a good job at. So this is one of the programs that we call Partners in Nature. Through the group that you see here, through Self-Enhancement Inc., also with the CIO, Center for Intercultural Organizing. Thank you very much for saving me on that, Eric. As well as a few others, we're bringing science-based experiences to many youth and burgeoning adults here in our community. For some of them, it's the first time they've been to a forest. Some of it is a problem of access. I know my parents weren't apt to go hiking or into the forest, and part of it is cultural for some other folks as well. So we're really trying to make sure that we engage with all aspects of our community. I mentioned this system plan, the strategic plan that we've been working on. We've engaged with thousands of folks throughout our community. Perhaps you've seen our booths at various farmers markets over the last couple of years, asking people, how do they care for nature? What have they experienced, and what would they like to see? So you see in the word cloud here, we gathered over 450 comments from throughout our region, the kinds of things that our public is passionate about. And this will continue to guide us. We've also worked with our agency peers at park districts, cities, and counties, as well as other partners, strategic partners in caring for nature and offering nature-based programming. And so we now have a draft system plan available. It was just posted on our website just last week. OregonMetro.gov/nature will take you to the landing page for much of this work, and you'll see a call out for that draft system plan. As we highlighted, we try to make sure that the work that we do, no matter where it falls on the spectrum with the fan, we try to make sure our work is grounded in your values. So when our team kicked off this system plan, one of the first rounds that they went through, and being out at those farmers markets and also doing an opt-in survey, which I know you've all signed up for, right? They culled that information from you, and these are the values that are guiding our system work. We know you're passionate about nature, and we want to make sure as we continue to make investments, whether they're land purchases or money for programs, that we are guided by your values. So that pretty much wraps it up in terms of our formal presentation, but we are both here to answer the vast wealth of questions you may have for us. And just a final pitch, I know every time I come and speak with you, I mention opt-in. It is a survey mechanism. We use a third party to run it for us so that the demographic questions that it asked you are housed there, and we don't mess with it at all. Your privacy is very important to us. But these surveys are really a great and easy way for you to engage with us and share your thoughts. So you can go to optinpanel.org and you can sign up for it. You can also see information on all of the past surveys. So what you see is what you get. The information I get is the same information you get to see. So there's nothing behind that curtain, folks. The only curtain involved is the one where that third party protects your private emails and your demographic information. So that's it for me. If you, I just want to check with Councilor Dirksen to see if there's any good stuff I might have missed.
No, I think Catherine's done a great job. I would just want to say that what we heard from talking to literally thousands of people about the natural areas is what we've heard is that they are interested in, it's important to people that we protect and preserve and restore our natural areas, but also make sure that people have access to them so that they too can be restored and can enjoy the nature as well.
Thank you so much, councilors. Really appreciate you being here. It was a great presentation. I certainly have a much greater understanding of Metro and how it works. And I think you have an awful lot of fans here, not just on paper. Ladies and gentlemen, I know you're already lining up for questions. And just a quick reminder, well, two reminders. You have to be a paid-up member of the forum in order to ask questions. And the second reminder is watch out for our Executive Director, Eric. He has remit envelopes.
I'll ask you to join.
First questioner. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Spencer Ehrman, a member of the forum. Thanks for coming today. I've heard Metro described as a government in waiting, in that its charter from the state legislature, its original charter, gives it the ability to undertake almost any activity that that it chooses. This may or may not be true, but I think in general, in fact, it is. You've clearly gone well into natural areas, and yet the largest natural area of them all, being Forest Park in Portland, goes wanting. Portland Parks and Rec is their budget is underserves Forest Park. So one question I have is, why not have Metro take Forest Park and add 5,000 acres to the 17,000 acres you have already? I would go on from there, though, to ask about other regional issues that could really use some help, transportation being one. Why not take the bridges in Portland from Multnomah County, which is a ridiculous arrangement, and begin managing those? Why not undertake a consolidation of the 40 plus water districts that serve the port, that serve the metropolitan area, and consolidate those so that we're assured of good regional planning? Finally, why not undertake air quality from a regional standpoint? DEQ is so they're like a piggy bank in Salem, and so their air quality budget is shrinking every year. Metro seems to have, while not unlimited, certainly relatively stable sources of revenue from which they could reform the Columbia Willamette air quality district. Sorry.
So I'm going to call time on his question.
Thank you. I apologize.
I think there are about four different parts to that question. So I'll let Craig speak to the specifics on transportation and air quality,
sure.
And I will try to speak to the natural areas and forest park questions, as well as regional responsibilities in general. Is that okay?
Perfect. Thank you. Sorry.
You're welcome. No, you're touching on a lot of really the frequency of these questions over the years. They're good questions. So on the natural area side, I talked about partnership. None of us are trying to displace the great value that each party brings. What, through our system plan, what we've been able to do is really clarify Metro's niche to all of us and to the great fabric, community fabric that we have with our cities and counties. Specifically to Forest Park, we have made additional investments in Forest Park, in sensitive lands that would help to complete the vision for Forest Park. We have also partnered with the City of Portland and the Forest Park Conservancy to invest in restoration efforts in the park. As we do this, we, the residents of the region, not just the City of Portland, we continue to love that park to death. So we're trying to do a better job together, but it's going to take some time for us to catch up so that Forest Park in its entirety is a much healthier place. But it's getting there. I know in my 25 years of living here, I've had the opportunity to see less ivy, a lot of great, tremendous work's gone in, more native plants, and so forth. So we've done a lot. Another example of how we work together, the native plant industry here in Oregon has grown tremendously because of efforts at Metro, Soil and Water Conservation Districts, and local park districts. So we've helped create a whole new cottage industry here in Oregon. On the regional responsibilities, you mentioned originally Metro was created through state action. Subsequent to that, the voters of the region have approved Metro's charter. There is a provision where Metro's responsibilities can expand to those of regional significance, matters of regional significance. In my time on the council, over 9 years, there was a question about should we include the siting of hospitals as part of that list of regional significance. Once again, we work with the public, but also our community partners, to look at these various questions and to see, you know, is this something that we should take on, or is it better done elsewhere? In that specific case, we decided that it wasn't in the region's best interest to take that on and to continue to rely upon the state. The specific topics that you were getting at on transportation and air quality, we do play a role in each of those, and each of these are areas where Councilor Dirksen has invested a tremendous amount of time as he's been a Metro Councilor, but also his leadership. So I, without further ado, I want to put in a plug for him. He's a great colleague and is a real expert for speaking to those.
All right. Thank you, Catherine. As Catherine says, we do have a regional responsibility when it comes to transportation, but it's a limited regional responsibility. I'm the chair of the JPAC. It's called the Joint Policy
Advisory
Committee for Transportation. And that is made up of representatives of the region, the areas around. We have a representative from each county, a representative for a city from each county, and then I'm the chair. And then we also have some other people like from the EPA and the Port of Portland who belong to that. And we make regional decisions around that table. But Metro itself, we don't actually have any funding of our own. We don't have dollars that we can spend to either repair or build new transportation facilities. We are a funnel for state and federal dollars where we get to decide where to distribute some of the money, but it has to be to projects that have been approved around that JPAC table with representatives from all the different partners around the region. That means that Metro doesn't own any facilities. We're not responsible for any streets or roads or highways or bridges. Those all belong to those regional partners that sit at that table. They bring proposals to us on where they believe the money should be spent. We review it as a group and decide the best way to spend the money that has the best regional value. And I think that gives us a very good perspective, an objective view, because we don't actually own any of it ourselves. There's no provincialism. We don't want only spend money on things we own, because we have the opportunity to look at everything from a regional view without having any actual, we don't have a dog in the fight ourselves. We can decide best which way, how things should be spent on an annual basis. That being said, there are definitely challenges, and there has been questions, particularly around the bridges, whether it still is the best for the county to have all of those, or if it should go to some other kind of a regional agency. These are discussions that we constantly have. And of course, we would only be able to do that with the agreement and approval of the majority of our regional partners around the area. And as with parks, Metro works best when we work to create partnerships around the region. And as with parks, it was made clear to us that they were very welcoming to us to be a partner, so long as we did not attempt to take over. All of our cities have their own parks department. They're very proud of them. It's part of their city identity. They would not be interested in turning that over to us. In the same way, cities and counties being responsible for the transportation system, they do not want to give up that local control. So it would be very challenging politically if we were to even to try to look at doing something like that.
Jim Cape, four member. Question for Craig. You spoke about how Metro works with counties and cities, but you never mentioned service districts. Was that a mistake, or was that a personal bias against the proven efficiency of Washington County service
districts? I'll speak for him. It was
absolutely
just an oversight.
No, I asked him.
Yeah, okay. I wouldn't call it a mistake. It was just an oversight. We definitely work very well with the service districts throughout the region, whether they're in Washington County or elsewhere, and are very appreciative of the great job that all of them do.
And we've given examples of that here today. Tualatin Hills Park and Rec District, Clean Water Services, Tualatin Valley Water District are just three.
Well, that lines right up with my question. I'm Bill Kroger, four member, and thank you both for coming in. You did a great job presenting your talking about Metro. You were talking about Fano Creek. And specifically, I'm interested in Greenway Park and the area down that area. I thought that was run by THPRD, and I guess you have a partnership, but I was wondering if you could maybe explain or talk about that a little bit more.
Either of us could.
So one of the niches that we play is to help acquire missing links. So for example, much of the extent along Fano Creek, we Metro, have been able to secure the underlying properties. And then in many of the links of the trail, the local park districts and cities have secured funding from various means to help build the trail. the park pieces along the way are really sort of like jewels on a necklace, and the cities and park districts along the way have generally acquired those people of those properties, sometimes with the local share dollars from the bond program. Anything you want to add?
Well, I would just say that earlier I talked about the cities having park districts, and that's true in many cases, but it's not true in all cases. And the city of Beaverton does not have a park district. When Tualatin Hills Park and Rec was created, the cities and the county within the border of THPRD agreed to give up their ownership of the parks to the park district, and the park district runs all the parks and natural areas within the district boundaries.
With the exception of City Park.
City Park, the city takes care of.
Does City of Beaverton actually have parks?
Yeah.
I thought THPRD, see, there you go.
Not all. Not 100%, but it's pretty darn close.
Hello, Elizabeth Burris, I'm a member. Very interested to see all your park responsibilities, but there's something I feel that Metro needs to focus on more, and that is land use planning. We have Senate Bill 100. I was part of Save Helvetia. We looked at the urban and rural reserve plan, which Metro approved, and we did not. We took it to the court, and the court threw it out. I think there has to be a stronger understanding of why Senate Bill 100 is one of our biggest opportunities to prosper. You spoke of agricultural land. I would say that we are very fortunate to have as much agricultural land, and we need to do everything we can to preserve it. I've just watched 400-year-old oak trees be cut down to put on a new overpass. I don't know who wanted the overpass except the developers, but certainly we've got to look out for these things. I have an example of why Senate Bill 100 is so important and why I think Metro needs to focus more on it. When I was in the United States Congress, we were opting for who would get the money for light rail. It was Los Angeles or Portland. Well, it wasn't my pretty face, but I was able to show those congressmen and women that because of Senate Bill 100, we know exactly where our development is. We got over $800 million to bring it to Hillsborough. Los Angeles didn't because they can't show that they have planning. So we were very disappointed that Metro would have approved that urban and rural reserve program, and I'm also very concerned that we're still in danger of losing agricultural land. And I would hope that you would focus as much as you can. Catherine, I know you go to all those meetings, but Save Helvetia is a small organization, and it's had to battle and win. And I don't want to see the next legislative session where we have another bill that says, oh, too bad, Senate Bill 100 is old, let's get rid of it. But thank you for your work, and thanks for coming here.
Thank you, Congresswoman. She is right that because of her efforts, built on the plans that we have here locally, made possible because of the visionaries, really the tremendous leaders we had in the 1970s. Oregon is unique in terms of its land use, valuing agriculture land, farmland, forest land, so it's farmland and forest land, our natural features, and healthy urban places. So we're trying to continue that legacy on for future generations. We just completed one of our state-mandated urban growth management cycles. In parallel to that, as Ms. First mentioned, the Court of Appeals pushed the reserve decision back to Metro and the three counties. The state legislature decided to legislate the urban and rural reserves in Washington County, so that's done, but we still have two loose ends. The Court of Appeals remanded a specific area in Stafford in Clackamas County, asking for, saying that there needed to be further clarification on transportation facilities. And the second is a small rural property set in Multnomah County.
So near Forest Park.
We're working with our county partners to try and address those specifics. In fact, We recently held two different public hearings to gain input from our communities. Remand. I mentioned that we just finished our most recent state required urban growth management decision. Our local government partners and some other industry folks were expressing great concern because the forecasts that we had to base that check on, that every 5-year urban growth report on, were completed just after the Great Recession ended. So we were in the early days of our recovery from that really long, horrible time that we hope to never see again in our lifetimes. So there was a great deal of skepticism. So we committed, rather than waiting for the next 6-year period, we would take a look in 3 years and see how are we trending. In addition, there are folks who felt strongly that, you know, things haven't changed since Senate Bill 100 in the 1970s. Personally, I'm scratching my head a little bit because we've made a lot of changes as recent as 2010. It's just that not too many local elected officials are as familiar with the depth of the information as we understand as Metro councilors, which is understandable because they're very busy managing what is on their plate as city mayors, city councilors, county commissioners. But once again, we will approach this in partnership, and you can be assured that your Metro Council, all 7 of us, is committed to an open and transparent process so that you will be made aware of what we are considering and seek your input. I think I pretty much touched on that. Is there anything I might have missed or glossed over?
The only thing I would add is that the urban and rural reserves process was a long process, over almost 4 years, actually. And what came out of that, the approved urban and rural reserves plan, some of which has now been remanded back to us, was the result of a lot of work between a lot of different groups, all of our partners around the region, and it required compromise and agreement between many disparate groups who did not have similar views on how the process should go. So what came out of it in the agreement was a compromise. And as someone once said, the definition of a successful compromise is when all parties are equally dissatisfied. And this being the United States, if you're dissatisfied, you can sue somebody. So we are challenged in the courts and we'll work through the court system.
Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, we're going to close the official part of our program today, but we have some questioners, and I know that Councilor Dirksen needs to leave as soon as possible, but I think that Councilor Harrington will be able to stay just a little bit to see if she can handle the 3 questioners. I just wanted to obviously wish everybody Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Happy Holidays, and all that neat stuff. I don't want to get into controversy. I'm not drinking Starbucks at the moment, but I do hope that everybody has a good holiday. Remember, we're back here on January 4th. We'll be listening to Representatives Parrish and Representative Gallegos talk about the upcoming legislative session. And again, I don't want to take too much away from this presentation, but I wanted to just caution you. There's a growing problem in Washington County. It's called naked doorknobs. Any of you who are walking around and see any naked doorknobs close to you, please, before you leave today, take one of these and put them on the doorknobs. It's really a serious problem. They get cold in the winter, and this can really be helpful as we try and spread our word. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for putting up with a tiny bit of humor. Once again, thank you to our guests today. And please, the questions will continue for just a few moments, but I just wanted to close our program today with thanks. Take care.
Do any of the questioners have a specific question for me particularly?
No.
Okay, I see one. Is that okay? Is that all right if he goes first?
Yeah.
Well, that worked well. Craig, just a personal question. You were mayor of Tiger.
I was.
And you've been a Metro Councilor.
Yes.
Which is the best job?
Can I be honest?
No.
Nothing's better than being a mayor. That's the short answer. I really enjoy being a Metro Councilor. It gives me the opportunity to continue to serve the community and the larger community. I couldn't be the mayor anymore because the city of Tigard has term limits. So it was, I either had to find a different seat somewhere else or go home, and I wasn't ready to do that yet. And so as much time as I spent at Metro when I was the mayor of Tigard, it seemed to me a logical step if I needed to make one.
But I'm thrilled to have the opportunity to work with Craig. He's very thoughtful. We don't always see things from the same perspective, but he's willing to chat with me about things, so we're always able to learn from one another and try and do the best that we can to serve you.
Thank you. I'll see you later.
Yeah, see you tomorrow.
Thanks, everybody.
I'll need to leave no later than 1:15, so if I start packing up, you'll know why.
Yeah, John Bell, forum member. I'm really concerned about affordable housing. Our rents are going up to $1,000 a month. Our percentage of ownership is going down 5 to 10%. And our new cost of construction is $400,000 plus. And which means you gotta make almost $150,000 to buy a house. Where can we get decent about affordable housing? They all don't have to be 6,000 square foot houses. They can be down to 1,200 or even $700 to $800 square foot. And we're not making any condominiums or smaller housing.
What you're touching on is a big need, and it's a really hard problem. In terms of, there are different aspects to the problem that I'd like to touch on. You are correct in looking at the demographics, that rents are going up, the percent of ownership is going down, and part of that is because of the financial challenges that we're all facing. The cost of health care, cost of retirement, and for our young people, they're paying unprecedented, they're holding an unprecedented amount of student debt. I was very fortunate in not having that when I finished college. So as your Metro Council and local government partners move forward, we are being informed by those demographics and those challenges. For the cost of construction, I've spoken before about how decades ago, really until about most recent 20 years, the federal government provided significant funds for us to finance the major infrastructure that was needed for new housing development. That is not the case anymore. In fact, with all aspects of funding through the federal government, we're lucky if we get a 60% match, meaning we still have to provide 40% of the dollars, and in some cases, 50-50. For example, with the Orange Line that just opened up, the local communities, Metro, the counties, the cities, had to provide 50% of the local match in order to secure that investment. So it is hard, but what you have is a commitment from all of your governments to continue to work on the problem. We know there's no silver bullet. We know it's not even silver buckshot. We're going to have to keep working on it together. I feel blessed that we have a wider range of housing solutions here in our region than we had 20 years ago, and some of that is by virtue of leadership through the state legislature and the state metropolitan housing rule. But you are correct. We have to keep working on it, and we don't have any easy answers.
Phil Nelson, forum member, and of course the International Climate Conference has just wound up, and I'm curious to know, has Metro any program going on for climate change factors, and do you have staff working on this, and are you going to be looking at what that conference produced? Thank you.
We'll definitely be looking at what the conference produced. At the end of the day, there are programs that come through where states are required to do different things, and Metro serves often as the metropolitan planning organization that must meet certain state and federal requirements. Clear example, the legislature in 2007 passed some legislation that required us as a state to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions. And our metropolitan region is the major metropolitan region of our state. So there were additional requirements placed on us. We had to come up with a plan so that our greenhouse gas emissions would stop growing by 2010, I think it was, or 2015. And then we had to demonstrate that we have plans to reduce them by 2035 and then again in 2050. I know Marilyn, by working not only as a board member of the Tualatin Valley Water District, but also as a longtime caring member of our community, was part of this program that we called Climate Smart Communities, where we worked together as a region to come up with a climate smart strategy that meets those state requirements for lowering our greenhouse gas reductions. So I don't know what the specific conference is coming to, but Oregon has been ahead in the nation. We have a good sense of managing our airshed. So there are really three sectors to our airshed. There's manufacturing, transportation, and the energy sector. A lot of our energy comes from hydro, not exclusively, but we're pretty well set compared to the East Coast that historically has relied on coal and now into natural gas. What we've tried to do is look at the percentages for manufacturing and transportation and try and really put the squeeze on transportation so that we free up as much of that budget, that airshed budget, for manufacturing, for jobs, okay? So that's why you hear us talking about reducing our fossil fuel dependent transportation need, is so that we follow up and do our part so that we can help support widespread economic growth throughout our state. So I hope that helps.
And it's not even 1:15.
Thank you very much, everyone. We really appreciate being invited to speak with you today. So thank you. And Happy New Year. I'll see you in the new year.
Good deal. Thank you.
I'm a blessed.